Welcome to Inside Creative Writing. I'm Robert Olin Butler, and I'm speaking to you from my offices here at Florida State University in Tallahassee, Florida. And I teach creative writing here at Florida State in both our undergraduate and our graduate programs. Our graduate program gives a master's in creative writing and a PhD in creative writing. We have something over 60 students here and a wonderful faculty of writers, writer teachers. And as part of Florida State University's sort of innovative approach to education, they have sponsored me and provided me terrific support in order to do this extremely unusual kind of pedagogical experiment. And what we're about here, and I know there may well also be some new viewers here tonight, thanks to, at the very least, a U.S. News and World Report story on this event. If you're just joining us, I've been here since October 30th, every night except Sundays, so I guess that makes this our 15th session. And what we've been doing is creating a short story. And we've done it, I've been doing this on the internet through webcasting on the morning of October 30th. I looked into a collection of mine. I collect old picture postcards. And I collect those cards, not just for the image on the front, and indeed sometimes not at all for the image on the front. The important aspect of this collection is the presence of an interesting, suggestive, subtext-rich, innuendo-rich inscription on the back. Many of these cards, most of them, I guess, are really from the first two decades of the last century. Before phones were common, people, not infrequently, poured their hearts out on the backs of old picture postcards. And over the past 11 or 12 years, I've been collecting these cards in antique malls and postcard collector shows and so forth. And I say not infrequently. It's rather infrequently. For every one card I've actually bought because the message suggested something to me, a real glimpse into a character, into a moment, most particularly into a yearning in the character, which is, as those of you who have been with me before know, I've said this many times, the yearning is at the heart of fiction. Well, for every one of those cards I found, I had to read 500 or 600 cards of rather stupefying blandness. But those special cards have been worth the search. And on the morning of October 30th, I chose a card from that collection, a card that I felt had a story hovering around it. And I'll point more about that card out to you in a few moments. But then I came to this office on that night, and I began to write. Every comma stroke, every word that I have written in this story has been written before your eyes in these webcasts. Every lousy, rotten, misbegotten sentence, there have been plenty of them. Wrong-headed metaphors, bad directions, the manifestations of that unkillable instinct to abstract and to generalize and to analyze in your prose. I mean, all of the ways that an artist struggles with the process have been visible to you in every moment, all its particularity,
literally every comma stroke has been done before your eyes. And tonight, I think we've reached a point where my instincts are telling me that we are very nearly at the end of the story. I think tonight the last raw words of the story will be written. Our work won't be done, but all the words will essentially be there. Now, you'll find, if this is your first visit here, that my working method is not to write a sprawling, highly approximated rough draft full of compromise decisions along the way. My working method is such as to that I need to work over the sentence before me as fully as I can before I go on to the next one, or at least work in very small units, several sentences, and then work them over, so that I proceed having refined and refined and rewritten and revised as I go, coming back into larger units. And even now we've read through the whole story, well, many times. And so if I'm correct in my intuition about the story, and that I'm will reach the climax and the fullness of it and the finish of it tonight, there will still be at least two nights of working things over in full. Now, if this is your first visit, I would like to point out to you that you've not missed the webcast experience. You've missed the live webcast experience, but every word and every comma stroke and everything I've said and all the questions I've answered, all of these things are now permanently archived at Florida State University's website. The web page through which you entered this very webcast right now provides you with a number of opportunities, and I'd like to just recap those for those of you who are now just joining us. That Inside Creative Writing homepage has on its bottom half a calendar, and each of the day blocks in the calendar for which we have done a webcast, you'll find an opportunity by clicking on your connection speed to rebroadcast, rewebcast that night's event in full. Each night is 2 hours, and so you can, at your leisure, watch everything that I've done here. Also, on each of those night boxes is an opportunity to see where the story stood at the end of each of those evenings. Up toward the top of the page, the web page, you'll see an icon which allows you to, and this is very important, to ask questions. And I encourage you to do that. From the feedback I've been getting through email and elsewhere, I know that a lot of the question and answers that we've been doing here has been as much of a help, has been also a big help to you. And I'm anxious to help you with anything you need to know about writing, especially about writing that aspires to art. And also about any of the decisions that I've made, no matter how minute,
If you are interested in the decisions I'm making, in the actual writing of this story, I'd be happy to illuminate those things for you to the best of my ability. And I encourage you to do this. You can email questions to me as I write. I have a graduate student on standby downstairs here in our building, who is watching the webcast and also fielding your email questions and putting them into hard copy form and bringing them up to me. And usually the last half hour or so of our webcast is spent answering those questions. So please send your questions along, especially now as we're wrapping up. My expectation for those of you who have been watching, particularly all or at least most of the time, my expectation is that tonight is Thursday, November 15th. My expectation is that after tonight, we will do a webcast tomorrow night, November 16th, and then Sunday night, November 18th. And I believe by then the story will be done. We had purchased enough webcast time, so that if the story took until November 20th, we could have been here doing that. But all along, the plan has been to write the story as long as it took. And I judged within 2 days of how long the process will have taken. And there may still be some surprises, but this is my present expectation. I'll know more by the end of this evening. But the point is that your opportunity to ask me questions, that window of opportunity is beginning to narrow. And so please avail yourself of that opportunity. We'll have plenty of time, I think, tomorrow night and Sunday. Probably we'll have both nights extra time, since I won't be actually creating new words, but working over the text as it stands. We'll probably have a little extra time both of those nights to answer questions. And of course, I'm anxious to do that, because I know that's a big help to you. The other thing that you can access there on the Inside Creative Writing homepage is an image of the postcard. You'll see it there near the top of the page, that image of a fragile-looking old biplane photo taken against the sky by someone on the ground. Just a usual person, not a professional photographer, person with a Kodak Brownie camera. And if you click on that postcard, you will be able to see it in greater detail, which is interesting, I think, in regards to the story and how I have read the subtext of the card. And also, you'll be able to see the message written on the back. And the message has always been very moving to me, because because of its seeming affectlessness. There's no affect here. No passion, no motive. This particular image and inscription resonated so deeply into my white-hot center, and that's where art comes from. Art comes from your white-hot center. It comes from your unconscious. It comes from your dream space. And those of you who've been launch into those phrases, you're probably murmuring them not without some vague irritation at this point, perhaps. Murmuring them at your computer screen with me, because I've said these things many times. But the fact is, they need to be said many times. It is the essence of the creative process. And so the repetition of them is important for that. But also, I've tended to articulate those things at the moments in the middle of the process where those aspects of the process were most clearly at play. And since they are often at play, where they are often the most salient aspect of process that's being worked out at that moment, since I've shared each moment of this process, of this writing of this story with you, it's natural then I would have repeated some of these things over and over, because that's what's happening at that moment. That's what, that is the main governing principle of process that is relevant at any given moment. And also, of course, I've repeated those things frequently, as I've, in the metaphor I've used before, it's like the hurricane warning scrolling across your screen over and over under your nightly sitcoms because a hurricane is coming, or a tornado warning, or whatever. Because if you tune in, just drop into these webcasts, as some of you are, if you watch for very long without being reminded of this, you may walk away with exactly the opposite impression of the creative process from the one that is actually true. And that is a function of this kind of event. Because the commentary that I offer, the analysis that I offer as we go, is not part of my process as I write in the privacy of my own study. And it, not only is it not an articulated thing, it's not, I'm not even articulating something that is in my head in those terms. The analysis and the commentary I'm giving is the translation of something that's deeply intuitive and instinctive and sense-based and dream-driven into the quite different discourse of analysis and commentary in order to point out to you what those intuitive, dream-driven impulses are. But don't confuse the translated articulation of them with the thing itself. And the thing itself is irrational, dream-driven, from the unconscious. And honestly, the unconscious is where I want to be, especially tonight, because we've come to a very important moment, I think, in our story. And it's time to go to the work now. Though I will spend a few minutes again, as I always do, going back to just touch up the most recent words I've written. And your commentaries and your observations have been very apt, and many of them, and most of them, and very, and even if I've not, perhaps done the thing you might have anticipated in response to some of them, the issues you raise are very valuable, and I'm grateful for it. You've been a very important part of this process, and I'm glad for it. Thank you. And I hope you continue to do that. The advantage you have over me is that in my trance, I write these things, and especially when we focus on the last several hundred words I've written, because you get a chance to look them over with a cool eye before I do. My impression is you're getting even better at this than you were before, and I hope that's true, because that's part of the teaching process, isn't it? Okay, so let me
Let me go back a ways and okay. I could not breathe at all. I rose up from where I'd been bending. And by the way, I do read aloud to myself, those of you who are new. Reading aloud is part of what I do, even in private. And I may not do it quite as much as I do here, but I do that a lot. So, I could not breathe at all. I rose up from where I'd been bending, and I stood straight and dragged the air into my lungs. And I opened my eyes, and before me was the tree line, the pines, and beyond them was the clearing where he fell and burned, Earl Sant. And he knew something now, right this moment. And he knew something now, right this moment. I'm looking at New Something, and this is such a crucial kind of perception for him, and I'm wondering whether to tap it just a bit more. Because he sees this, he thinks of this dead man as somebody who possesses a kind of knowledge, and that's been what's been burning at Paul ever since he saw the plane go down. He had no frame of reference for the crash of this plane. And if you've been with us from before, you know, but if you're new, I make no secret of the fact, although I probably, if this had been strictly in the privacy of my own study, I would have made more of a secret of it to myself, but in a sense. But I know that my deep, hot center is engaged in this story because of the events of 9/11. No question about it. I, like many of you, maybe all of you, I had emblazoned on my consciousness on 9/11 an image not just of the zeitgeist at this present moment, not just of geopolitics and terrorism. Those things were certainly part of what I saw, but what we all experienced went far deeper than that. What we saw was an image of our own mortality. And it was an image that came to us in such a concrete and direct way that it got past our usual defenses about death. We all have these ways of keeping the notion of death manageable in our lives. But for us, the events of 9/11 produced images that got past those defenses, and we were faced with trying to understand what this is all about in a new way. And so it is for Paul, our narrator, seeing this biplane fall, this Barnstormer crash and die. And the section we're going over tonight, of course, is where, in a very intense way, Paul is finally getting through to those really important questions. And, as I said, part of it has to do with his sense that Earl Sant knows something. And so I'm going to tap that. And see if is appropriate. Let's see.
I could not breathe at all. I rose up from where I'd been bending, and I stood straight and dragged the air into my lungs, and I opened my eyes, and before me was the tree line, the pines, and beyond them was the clearing where he fell and burned, Earl Sant. And he knew something now, knew something, right this moment, that I desperately wished to know. He had been alive above me in the sunlit air just yesterday, and now he knew the great truth of it all. Let's see if that is better. There are other ways to tap it. I could not breathe at all. I rose up from where I'd been bending, and I stood straight and dragged the air into my lungs, and I opened my eyes, and before me was the tree line, the pines. There'll be a moment of perception there, and that's why I put the comma. Those commas for me, as I've talked about before, they nuance the emotional beats. I could not breathe at all. I rose up from where I'd been bending, and I stood straight and dragged the air into my lungs, and I opened my eyes, and before me was the tree line, the pines, and beyond them was the clearing where he fell and burned, Earl Sant. And he knew something now, right this moment, something that I desperately wished to know. He had been alive above me in the sunlit air just yesterday, and now he knew the great truth of it all. Yeah, I like that better, to tap it, instead of repeating the words. I stepped forward, moved toward the trees. My breath had returned, fragile, easily taken away. But I breathed deep once and again, and I walked into the darkness of the trees, and I was filled with the smell of pine all about me, and the smell of the duff beneath my feet, and with other smells, not of the forest, faintly still of smoke in the air and the fuel of the airplane. I pressed on, my face lowered, feeling the trees on the back of my neck, in my shoulders, in a faint wrenching upward in my chest. I'd been around trees often in my life. I made a life from the forest before I became who I am, a man with a desk and a bank and a Georgian revival home and a wife and a son and a daughter and a special pew in a church where the deacons sit, and I know nothing about anything. I know only I must press past these last few trees and into this clearing, which I do. It is empty. It is empty. Earl Sant's aeroplane. One of you mentioned a plane, and I caught that myself very quickly. Plane is too modern a word, and you'll notice that I have been scrupulously using aeroplane all through the text here. It is empty. It is empty. Earl Sant's aeroplane was here, and now it is gone. I move out to the center. I am surrounded by high pine, and there is something, a shapeless patch of burnt earth. I slow and stop before it. He burned here. He vanished from this life here. I take another step. I stand precisely where he fell. I stretch out my arms as if to fly, and they are contained within this black bareness. I hold fast to the steering column, and my wings are still whole, and I am racing toward those distant pines, and a thought occurs to me. I sit on the back of a horse. I am high up, above the tree line, on a slender thread of a path. Not even the smell of pines has risen this high. I pause and I look below me. Faces turn up, their hats raised high in the air. Treetops point up to me, and I have nothing inside but an enormous quiet. I find myself separated from all that I've known, from every touch, every word, every face. I have lifted up into the air, high on this mountain, with nothing around me but the empty sky, high in the air above this meadow, and I think this is how it feels. To be free. To be utterly alone. And my hands clench on the reins. There is only one more thing to feel, to know. My hands clench harder, wanting to slip hard to the right, to leap into that empty sky beneath me. Earl and I. One of you, Tracy Hessler, asked me about this hands wanting to slip hard to the right. She hears that as the wanting to slip to the right being the hands. And you're right, Tracy, that's exactly right. That's what it is. You notice that his hands, and all of this, the I is becoming very ambiguous many times. Sometimes it's clearly Paul. Sometimes it's clearly Earl. All of the time, they are getting mixed and blurred together, back and forth. And realize that his hands are clenching here. Let's see if I use it up here too. I hold fast to the steering column. We know his hands are tight on the steering column as well. But he's also holding the reins of his horse. Now, if his hands slip hard to the right, what that means is he is deliberately pulling on the reins. This act is not an act of, is not an accidental act that he is imagining. The impulse is not the impulse of embracing an accident. He is holding the reins. And when his hands clench harder, wanting to slip hard to the right, that means his impulse is indeed for the hands to slip to the right, which means to turn the horse sharply to the right and induce this, the leap into that empty sky beneath me, Earl and I. It's a very complex paragraph where Earl and Paul fade in and out of each other. And I don't want to pick it apart line by line at this moment, but I would encourage you to think about, meditate on how Earl and Paul become separate and come together and separate and come together. And Paul is trying to understand here even the act of some kind of suicide or an embrace of death somehow. Suicide's not, I mean, see, this is where the abstractions break down. This story, in this way, you know, I normally get very uncomfortable about this, but I think the story has earned a kind of complexity. Where to call it the impulse to suicide is just reductive and not really accurate. There's something
This meditation is to look at death, and the ultimate way to look at death is to walk into it somehow. And he wonders if Earl had that temptation. Because apparently, in the Allegheny Mountains, in the dark, he did. Papa. For a moment I do not recognize the voice. Papa. It is drawn near. I look. It is Matthew. He stands before me. His face is smudged. His hair is tousled. His eyes are fixed hard on mine. Okay. All right, it's time to create some words. And if this is new for you, I do use music to help focus me. And I'll turn that on now. Puccini, highlights of Turandot. Normally, I don't use music with words, but I don't know Italian, so it's not a distraction. I have to tell you one thing right now, and this is, I've told you about this little cold I've been fighting. And you know, I'm trying to share all of my process with you. And I've been fighting a cold all week, but that does not stop me from writing. But right now, I'm having trouble breathing, and so I'm going to take a couple of pseudoephedrin so I can breathe for the rest of this session. Because I find, and this is a matter of process, I would recommend breathing as you write. Pardon me. It actually facilitates the process somehow. And I'll make this point again every time I've mentioned the fact that I've been a little less than perfect physically, is that a little less than perfect physically is absolutely no excuse not to write. The demands, physical demands, the demands of concentration, and the emotional and psychological demands of going into your unconscious as deeply as you must go to write a work of art. There's the level of concentration needed to do that, to meet all of those demands, is such that if you go back every day, once you forge that link into your unconscious, once you go back, and then you go back the next day and the next and so forth, it's always daunting, but it's doable and much more readily doable if you go back every day. You cannot write weekends. You cannot write this week and not next. You can't put it off till the holidays. You cannot, if you wish to write fiction and you aspire to create art, you have to write every day. Now, the one qualifier is
I find, and you'll have to figure your own process out, and don't assume that this is going to be all right, but I can take one day a week off. And I'm sort of fretful and, you know, out of sorts, but I can go back then on the next day and it's there. But if I like 2 or 3 or 4 days go by, then the 3rd or 4th or 5th day I go back, and it's like I've never written a word before in my life. So you need to keep that up. And sickness is a, you know, that's one of those things you're going to have to make a decision on. If it does not really affect the work, and if it does not, and you can't just let it affect it. I mean, it really has to insistently affect it in spite of all your efforts. If it does not affect the work, I put it away the other way around. If in spite of all your efforts, it affects the work, or if your health is put in some sort of jeopardy by working, then you'll have to take off, and you're going to just have to pay the price when you come back. But if that's not the case, then keep working. So, in a way, I've, you know, been almost grateful to have shared this little head cold with you, because it's a good object lesson. Now, I've got to stop talking. Some ways this whole project has been a kind of exercise in schizophrenia, that I'm two people here, the analyst working from quite a different place than myself, and the artist trying to work from the dream space. So now, folks, I'm going to have to let go of the talk for some time, because we are in a very delicate part of this story, and I've got to work through from the unconscious here without interruption. So the music goes on, the commentary stops, and I hope that the words will be worth it. Right now I'm working on a technical problem I can talk to you about. I want to make sure his arms go down. The last we hear is I stretch out my arms. But I want those arms down pretty quick.
Ooh, this is interesting. Very interesting. I'm just noting how I have shifted into the, our voice has shifted into the first person. I mean, sorry, into the present tense. Do you notice that? Let's talk about that before I get back. This is something that I find I do not infrequently. If you look at my other, and I've been writing in the first person now for a long time, started with my sixth novel, The Deuce. It went into my Pulitzer book, Good Scent, and all those stories, and then everything I've written since has been in the first person. And sometimes when a first-person narrator is speaking about a story that's happened in the past. He will speak in the past tense. But at moments of great emotional intensity, well, you know, I told those stories that I wrote, The Deuce and the stories in A Good Scent from a Strange Mountain, They Whisper, Tabloid Dreams, Deep Green Sea, Mr. Spaceman, and now my new book, Fair Warning. Those are all told in the first. Those were all told in the first person, and I told those stories. But when I did, as I used the third person voice, and moments of great intensity of emotion began. Things change, because as the emotion becomes more intense, the voice shifts to the first person. The Deuce speaks in the first person in matters of emotional intensity. Now, you've been listening to me speak here in my first person voice for the last several minutes. And I just shifted from the third person to the first person. I described my books and how I wrote in them. And when I began to talk about emotional intensity in my characters, even though I was describing the process of those past books, which I had just talked about in the past tense, I started talking about them in the present tense. I just did it. And there's something quite real about that. And I just want to show you where it takes place in this story, because I think it's interesting to notice it. He knew something now, right now, something that I desperately wish to know about death, about the truth of it all. And so he is about to go into the trees and find out what it is about death. I stepped forward, moved toward the trees. My breath had returned, fragile, easily taken away, but I breathed deep once and again. So forth. It's all past tense here. I pressed on, my face lowered, feeling the trees on the back of my neck. I've been around trees often in my life. I made a life from the forest before I became who I am. He's in this quest in the forest to understand death. And there's a declaration of who he is. I became who I am, a man with a desk in the bank, in a Georgian revival home, and a wife and a son and a daughter in a special pew in a church where the deacons sit, and I know nothing about anything. Here it is. I know nothing about anything. I know only that I must press past these last few trees and into this clearing, which I do. And from there on, we are in the present tense. and it's, I'm just trying to get back into the unconscious. And I was not in the unconscious here yet. I'm still trying to make that transition. And that's when I wrote down, Maddie, I said. Last night, this was written in a white heat. And I've got to get back there now. But I was going back to the conventional past tense, and he is definitely in the present tense now. Thank you. Take another step. I stand precisely where he fell. For a moment, I stretch out my arms as if to fly, and they are contained within this black bareness. I hold fast to the steering column, and my wings are still whole, and I am racing toward those distant pines, and a thought occurs to me. I sit on the back of a horse. I am high up above the tree line on a slender thread of a path. Not even the smell of pines has risen this high. I pause and I look below me. Faces turn up, their hats raised in the air. Treetops point up to me, and I have nothing inside but an enormous quiet. I find myself separated from all that I've known, from every touch, every word, every face. I have lifted up into the air, high on this mountain with nothing around me but the empty sky, high in the air above this meadow, and I think this is how it feels, to be free, to be utterly alone, and my hands clench on the reins. There's only one more thing to feel, to know. My hands clench harder, wanting to slip hard to the right, to leap into that empty sky beneath me. Earl and I. Papa, for a moment I do not recognize the voice. Papa, it is drawn near. I look. It is Matthew. He stands before me. His face is smudged, his hair is tousled, his eyes are fixed hard on me. I want him to go away from this place, quickly. I lift my hand, a vague gesture, and I cannot find words. I lift my hand to him, a vague gesture, and I cannot find words. Maddie, I say, just that. I am within the circle of Earl's fire, and he is outside. Son. And my son is outside. I try to step to him, but I am rooted here. I look up at the trees all around, and then back to my son. His face is turned up to me, waiting. I know too much.
I want him to run away now, not just from this place, but from me. Go on home, I say, the place between his... place, right? At the most crucial moments, the tiniest little semantic crap gets you. It always does. So let's just fix it. I know too much. I want him to run away now, not just from this place, but from me. Go home. Go on home, I say. His brow furrows very slightly. I step from the circle. I reach out. My hand goes to him. My thumb lands gently on his brow. Tries to smooth the furrow away. He backs off. I didn't mean to frighten him. I carry too much in these fingertips now. But suddenly he smiles. Papa, he says, look. His hand comes from behind his back. I don't recognize the object at first, hanging limply over his hand. His hand. His hand comes from behind his back. I don't recognize the object at first, hanging limply over his fingers. It's his, Matthew says. And now I can see. Earl Sant's goggles. Matthew lifts them. I found them, he said. I struggle once again to draw a breath. The moments I have yearned to share, he entered them looking through this thing in my son's hand. Is the ambiguity, Earl Sant. Yeah, the ambiguity of that he is not. Functional. Go on home, I say. His brow furrows very slightly. I step from the circle. I reach out. My hand goes to him. My thumb lands gently on his brow. Tries to smooth the furrow away. He backs off. I didn't mean to frighten him. I carry too much in these fingertips now. But suddenly he smiles. Papa, he says, look. His hand comes from behind his back. I don't recognize the object at first, hanging limply over his fingers. It's his, Matthew says. And now I can see. Earl Sant's goggles. Matthew lifts them. I found them, he said. His hand comes from behind his back. I don't recognize the object at first, hanging limply over his fingers. It's his, Matthew says. And now I can see. Earl Sant's goggles. I found them, he says. I struggle once again to draw a breath. The moments I have yearned to share. Earl Sant entered them, looking through this thing in my son's hand. But before I can think of what to do, Matthew grasps the goggles at each end, and he lifts them high, and quickly the strap goes over his head. High and quickly is not a functional confusion there. Goes quickly over his head, and the goggles slide down and around his face, and I can see his eyes for a moment, his child's eyes, the eyes of my boy, faint there and distant, and his face angles, and his eyes vanish. The panes of glass go blank from the light, and my son lifts his arms. He lifts them like wings, and he turns to his left, and he begins to run.
He runs swooping and lifting and falling. He runs. Look, Papa, he cries. Look, I'm Earl Sant. I know too much. I want him to run away now, not just from this place, but from me. Go on home, I say. His brow furrows very slightly. I step from the circle. I reach out. My hand goes to him. My thumb lands gently on his brow, tries to smooth the fur away. He backs off. I didn't mean to frighten him. I carry too much in these fingertips now. But suddenly he smiles. Papa, he says, look. His hand comes from behind his back. I don't recognize the object at first, hanging limply over his fingers. It's his, Matthew says. And now I can see. Earl Sant's goggles. I found them, he says. I struggle once again to draw a breath. The moments I have yearned to share, Earl Sant entered them, looking through this thing in my son's hand. Before I can think of what to do, Matthew grasps the goggles at each end and he lifts them high, and the strap goes quickly over his head, and the goggles slide down and are on his face, and I can see his eyes for a moment, his child's eyes, the eyes of my boy, faint there and distant, and his face angles and his eyes vanish. The panes of glass go blank from the light, and my son lifts his arms. He lifts them like wings, and he turns to his left and he begins to run. He runs, swooping and lifting and falling. Look, Papa, he cries. Look, I'm Earl Sant. One of you asked recently, and I gave a long, kind of rambly, abstract, analytical answer. One of you asked recently, how do you know when it's done? It's done. It's done. Which doesn't mean we don't have some more work to do. We do. But it's time for questions tonight. At this point. And I'll do the best I can with these. Tomorrow, as I say, we'll do a review of the last several hundred words in the story. And then we'll do a full text edit. And I'll deal with a lot of your questions. And then I'm glad to have the Saturday night off, actually. I like the thing to cool off for 48 hours. And then the last step, I need to do this on text, so I will print it out sometime Sunday afternoon and just read it, give it another read. We'll do a thorough look at the working over of it tomorrow together. Then I'm going to read it Sunday before I come in, because I like to see it printed out, and this is a read-through that is silent. And then I'll share on Sunday, I'll share whatever changes occur to me from the silent read through. And then I will read the story to you. We'll hear it together in a direct way, not on the screen, but from text. I will read it to you. And then I'll deal with a lot more questions on Sunday, and our project will be at an end. So let me deal with one question here from Mimi Carmen about endings. She says, on endings, which I've heard your responses, I'm still not sure if some part or direction is part or some part or direction is part of the original inspiration motif, and the yearning which is going to happen, like the recurring resonance in music, makes up part of the composite of the dream. I understand what you said last night, that when the comment, moment or epiphany takes place, you will just know it. I'd like to clear this once more about endings, if you wouldn't mind. I think I know what you're trying to get at here, Mimi. Is the ending somehow there in the original conception? Not explicitly, and in fact, not at all, really. But it is possible, as I said before, it is possible for me to have some intuition in a given story. I didn't with this one, I don't most of the time, but it's possible that I have an image of some climactic moment in a character's life, having discerned that character's yearning. And maybe even that helps me discern the character's yearning. As with any conception, and as you know, I've taught explicitly taught a method of pre-dreaming a novel, and you can use it in short stories as well, where you do dream and encourage the dreaming of and the inspiration of and the seeing of moments to come. But the crucial thing about that, and it's crucial in that method I taught you as well, is that none of that gets locked in. None of that becomes something that you then try to move the story toward. Anything that gets fixed like that down the road in the story is going to be a destructive thing if you really begin to will the story to go in that direction. And that's the thing about endings. So I have a hunch that Tom Bly is outside the door. How do you know? What do you know? Hello, Tom.
Hello.
Good to see you, my friend. You thank you very much. Okay, before I do get to those questions, let me just finish Mimi's questions. This is the fourth question that she included in this long email, though the fifth one that I'm dealing with. I did one of the fifth one last night. She says, during the dream or trance, does the story progress or go forward? Or does it merely put us into the center of the ongoing problem? Since this is not actually a dream, such as when we sleep, what happens during this dream state as we write to make the story unfold? I can close my eyes and visualize any scene, but can this turn into a dream which moves me on to my moment of revelation? Excellent question, Mimi, and yes, you can. Think about your daydreams. Think about your daydreams when, for example, you know, a grocery store clerk is really surly and nasty to you, and you just go kind of nah, 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 in front of her, and here's the change, and you go. And you're in the car, and you're driving along, and you fight with this woman for miles down the road. And that daydream that you have control of, and it's very vivid, and you see her and you see yourself, and she says some things and you say some things that you didn't say, but you now are creating in this daydream, and she says some things back to that, and you say some more things and so forth, and then she throws a head of lettuce into your bag, and the bag splits, and you throw the lettuce back into her cash drawer, whatever. It's a silly example, but the point is, you, in daydreams, you are used
you know, your daydreams, where we want something or fear something or try to rearrange something in our lives that we did wrong or whatever. We dream the forward movement of action occurs in those kinds of daydreams all the time. Well, it's the same thing. And where the forward momentum comes in the dream state of the artist is by that other thing that I harp on all the time, yearning. In that dream state, inside the sensibility of your character, you are constantly holding on intensely to the yearning that the character has. And in the yearning, from the yearning comes the forward movement of the daydream. You let that character move toward the yearning, the thing that she yearns for. And then things come to block that, and things happen, and she tries to work it out, and so forth and so on. So the dream state is not a static thing, by no means. It's a thing that that can be very dynamic and actually is very much so in a way that you usually are able to control in this other kind of daydream. Your night dreams, too, of course, are full of action and forward movement. Fred from Fort Thomas, Kentucky says, Earl Sant's goggles return after being mentioned earlier in the description of his descent. Goggles seem a natural item to feature at this point in the story, which is so much about seeing. After all, the inspiration for the story was a snapshot, a captured image. How soon in your process did you know that Earl Sant's goggles would play a part? Only a couple of nights ago, Fred, a couple of sessions ago, in one of these nighttime trips into this office, where just the night and the headlights ahead and the movement of the highway and some music I play on the automobile CD player, and I just open up to the unconscious, and I had a vision of Matthew, because I knew, you know, we were kept pointing toward those, back to those woods. At some point, I could foresee in this kind of dreamstorming thing that I've been teaching, I could foresee that he's going to have to go back to the woods. That if he really wants to understand Earl, he has to go back to where he fell. And once he's there, I realized that Matthew would be there as well. Matthew would, if you know, I've gone out into the to play earlier as well, with a kind of shrug. He was still, when asked if everything was all right, that something was troubling Matthew. He went out there too. But what Matthew found was the child's thing. The child found the goggles. At first, I had imagined he would find a shoe. I knew he wanted something of Earl's would be found by Matthew, and then I remembered the goggles from that very same image. So at the time that the goggles were first entered the story, I had no idea that they would come to play as crucial a role in the story as they finally did. It was much later, only very recently, that I began to anticipate that. I did not know until tonight, in the act of creating it, what role the goggles would play, but suddenly the terrible gesture is that Matthew is both the child here, oblivious to death, and trapped in his humanity into dying. He is Earl Sant. We are all Earl Sant. Paul was Earl Sant. And even in trying to keep this terrible knowledge from his son a little longer, he is a child. Go home. Go even away from me, because now I have seen something terrible and I don't want to drag you down. I want to only smooth that wrinkle from your forehead. And Matthew has found something terribly close to Earl himself, because Matthew saw that.
and it's now translated into a child's world, which is the irony. That last image is ironic in that he is a child and free of the terrible dark implication, but he puts Earl Sant's goggles on, and suddenly Paul can't even see his child's eyes anymore. And Matthew lifts his arm to imitate Earl, as a child would play a game. And he declares himself to be Earl Sant. And the act is both the child's freedom from certain kinds of knowledge, and at the same time, in a terrible way, it is also a power, you know, an image of how he too, this child, every child is also mortal, and he is Earl Sant. Fred elaborates his question here. He says, how did you decide to invest the goggles with special significance, and when did you know that Matthew would be the one to find them? I guess I've answered that part of it too. And honestly, it doesn't feel as if I have invested the goggles with special significance. It feels as if they were there all the time, ready to take on this special thing. And you do a lovely job there, Fred, and that's kind of what inspired me to articulate, now that a few minutes have passed since I wrote it, articulate a little bit about what that final image, where that final image came from in the depths of this story and in the depths of me. So the significance came out of the organic object. It was the thing already in the object, already with its sensual pattern in a certain way, as you point out, Fred. The seeing, to going into the air and seeing the future, seeing ultimately his own death, seeing something about the human condition, all the seeing. It was there, and so that object came back quite naturally. And this thing I've been talking about, the organic wholeness of a work of art, everything resonating into everything else, that is a clear example of that, a clear manifestation of that wholeness. The thing ultimately that resolved the story came from deep within it. And its sensual pattern resonated into the heart of that story. And I didn't notice it at first. Those goggles just slipped in like the clue in a detective novel. It's just, there it is. And now it returned to show its full significance. But I didn't invest it somehow. It feels like it had found its own way. A.P. Cohen says, concerning the scene you began with tonight, Paul is holding the reins, his hands slipping to the right. Earl and Paul fade in and out from each other. Then you switch into the present tense. You use Earl and I, and not Earl Sant, as previously used throughout the story. What is the significance of this? That's a good question. I dealt with it a little bit last night in the text, because Earl, and instead of Earl Sant, came into the story, and I recognized why my unconscious had done that. Because, in fact, the naming of people, how Paul names people, and indeed how Paul is named in the story, became an important motif, a way in which the emotional valences of things were made manifest in this story. And here, then, in the most intense examination by Paul of Earl's death and his vision of death, at that moment, as his own
personality gets so caught up with Earls and the intermix. Finally, and for the first time in the story, Earl Sant turns into Earl. So that's the significance of that, and it is significant. I think it's an important point, and I'm glad you raise it. Jane in Tallahassee has several little questions here. By what rules do you measure your own story's success? Oh, boy. The story's success comes from something from my deep, intuition, my deep sense of things that this is the vision I had. There's a kind of, yes, you know, the vision that is beating within this organic object feels like it's something like giving birth, isn't it? Because I would imagine, I don't know what a woman feels like when her child comes out of her body, but it is a thing that is of her and is not of her. It is in its beautiful simplicity of the child's body. It is, it speaks of all that had been in her up to that moment. It feels like you've never laid eyes on the child itself, perhaps a sonogram image, which is a kind of like a dreamstorming, pre-dreaming, the shadowy outlines of your story. But until that moment of birth, you have never seen this wonderful thing that had been growing within you, and now there it is, externalized, no longer it is you and it is not you. It has been part of you all along and is now separate from you and in the world and touchable. And that's the feeling. And if I can feel that, I feel the story is a success. Of course, you have to count the toes and the fingers. And in this birthing, if you count the toes and there are 8 of them altogether, you know, you can go back and add some toes. Or if there are 12, you can take a couple out or whatever. You can. That's the revision process. So this ultimate success still lies ahead of us here in the next couple of nights as we work them over. Have you published work and later wished you could have changed something about it or perhaps held off on publishing it altogether? You know, I was spared that. To be honest with you, Jane, those things that I would have deeply regretted never got published. And I tell you, I have a lot of that, more than most people, I think. A million words of that, literally. I have 5 unpublished, truly dreadful novels and 40 god-awful short stories and 12 terrible full-length plays, and none of it has seen the light of day. And all of it would have been embarrassing, and I would have regretted publishing it. Perhaps because I did so much bad work in private, driving myself forward with a mix of things, determination and so forth, but also a lot of self-deception at the time. Don't underestimate the power of self-deception to help you persevere through hard times. The stuff that I've published, I'm proud of. I'm happy to say that, and it's true. Do I still at times write stories that I consider to be failures? You know, I've learned something about my unconscious, Jane. There are stories that I know I'm writing on some level all the time, and some of the stories that I kind of brainstorm in the direction of or open myself up to, and I realize, look, that I'm going to regret that if I plunge in there. Over the years, I've gotten to know my unconscious well enough that the stories I want to write, I can distinguish from the stories that are trying to get me to write them. But if I do, then I would have I would fail at it and have that problem. So I'm going to give you honest answers here, and there's certainly nothing to be ashamed of if you write stories that don't work and you consider them a failure and you put them away. As I say, God knows I've had more than my share of that. But it happened before I started publishing, thank goodness. And since I've been publishing, I've gotten pretty good at putting the stories that would fail aside before I really begin them. And I think one of the things is that I'm very, very, very careful I have a standard for myself, which I hope others can, you might benefit from, all of you, from learning, is that when a character presents itself in my unconscious, if I do not have a very serious and strong intuition into that character's deepest yearning, then I do not begin to write the story. And I think that's probably accounts for more failed stories, more stories that have begun, that are begun by writers and that fail and that you put away, or even that you get published and wish you hadn't. That factor is that those stories, I suspect more often than not, are turn out badly or less than the way you want them because they are begun without a clear fix on the character's yearning. And if that happens, your story begins to develop only, you know, on the page, but in a static way. You then do, in fact, as somebody else mentioned, you get involved in the problems of the character and the attitude and the point of view and the voice and all this other stuff. All that stuff comes out, but if you haven't got a good fix on the yearning, you thrash around and then you start willing it into being and so forth, and trying to make it work, and the analytical faculties take over and you stress and you force it, and all of that stuff then leads to a story that doesn't really work, and you end up putting it away, or some of that stuff gets published, especially if you write well on the surface, and you go back later and you go, you know, that just didn't really work to my standards. And so, because I don't write a story, don't even begin one, if I don't have a good fix on the yearning, maybe that's why I don't throw too much away. All right, well, we've reached the end of another session, and this has been a very important one indeed. I hope you come back with me tomorrow, though, in spite of the fact of no new words being written. There's important revision work to do now, and we need to do it together, and I encourage your questions. Thank you very much, and good night.